those were fun times. And I think that one thing about the Serge is that, you know, we know that Serge made it, but Serge is a very, you know, unique personality.
Yeah.
And I think
very
that one of the things about him is that he made a machine that was so open-ended that he's surprised by what happens. That's really a brilliant.
That aspect that he's manifesting is synthesizing, but he as an individual, he's changed a little bit maybe by sharing information and diagrams and so forth. He's been very accommodating to the whole community. And I think really responsible for all of the various iterations of the Serge modular system, because he's just, he just let all of the basic diagrams be known. It's really awesome, much.
Yeah, it's very interesting what's happened with it all, because as you mentioned, you couldn't give them away for a while. And I know most people that had Serges, back in the days from their moms, they sold them or whatever.
Yeah.
At some point, and I'm like one of the few people who did it, and I didn't necessarily use it all of that time. There were some times, some years where it didn't go down the box, but in the long run, it's just so interesting to me that this thing that I had that I knew that had a great value, but nobody in the world agreed with me, is back, and not just the Serge, but the whole modular synthesizer concept, the analog, which it's morphed into a new digital phase, but still.
We talked about this, and it's one of the things that really fascinates me about this, is that when we were doing our thing with this instrument, it wasn't like you could go down the street and find somebody else doing something similar, right? There were a couple of other people in town, like Not Human had his big SMS system, but there really weren't. There wasn't really anybody that I knew of outside of, say, universities. And then you book time, and the university didn't just have one of these things living with you. And that whole approach, now with the advent of Eurodrag and singing and sort of stuff, has become more something where I do feel like I could probably go down the street and find one of my own neighbors sitting there with a Eurodrag system that's probably on right now.
I was amazed when I was in Sweden. I was in a very rural area of Sweden, but where I was staying, there was a building. You go in that building, there was a big search thing there for recording. The fellow who was doing our sound and was our partner in putting the whole thing together lived on a farm about 5 miles from there. And you go into one of the farm outbuildings, and there's a studio in there.
Who was that fellow?
What's that?
Who was the guy that was up in the assistant in Sweden?
Well, Callie Callender was the producer of it, and that's who had the first studio that I mentioned.
Yes,
and that's where I actually lived when I was there.
Yeah.
And then the other guy is Eric Ponder. I'm embarrassed that I might have to dub this in. Eric, though, was our partner in putting this together, and
I'm curious because I used to follow this guy somewhere in Northern Europe on Facebook.
Do you recall his name?
No, I don't. First name is Kurt something.
Oh
yeah,
I know exactly who you mean.
Yeah. His music's pretty good.
It is.
Yeah,
it is. I kind of became more aware of him just maybe in the last year and a half or so.
Ditto. Lynner Rudis.
Yes.
Do I pronounce that properly?
I believe so.
She is fantastic. But that's more of a digital synth sound, more of an electronic sound. But because she's working with an early digital synthesizer, it has a very warm quality to it. But her body of work is just like, wow. Really, wow.
Well, this field is filled with people that are doing amazing things.
Yeah.
And our audience is filled with, I don't mean our audience, but the
thank you, you
too. Not really hearing it fully yet, but...
no, thank you, you too. You know, like, but even like 50 people listening to Alien, you know, is a big step up for her. I'm not sure she did much performance. I think she was another, you know, academic and kind of like a recluse and so forth and so on. Or at least cloister, you know, like publishing or something. And she was like a vital and creative woman. I'm not really familiar with the biography, so I should not speak too much on this.
I'm not either, I have to say, but I have heard some of her music. It's quite interesting.
Yeah.
So much good stuff being done, and you're right about YouTube. There's a lot of competition there, but for instance, the figure that I published just like 4 or 5 days ago.
Yeah.
As you see, probably about 500 views there. Nice.
Yeah, so. That's actually, I think that's a big number for you, isn't it?
It depends. I mean, I've some videos that have had like 12,000 views.
It takes a long time to build that up, right?
So, the first one I ever did, which I didn't really do, but it was that first performance that I did at Robot Street. Who knows what that's all about?
Well, there's all these people buying Eurorack and stuff out there, like, whoa, what's the older guys are doing here?
Yeah, and the products, you know, this the information exchange of product and so forth, you know. The Church of the Super Search, for me, very, very charming and precious moments of time. And also, guys, the 40th anniversary of Serge. That's another thing you can pursue a little bit. And it's real interesting stuff. It's like everybody's on there. Todd Bard, you know, like Cal Arts.
Oh, you're speaking to the music from there.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, that's something that you and I are going to get together about.
Yes, right. You have to beat on me a little bit. Actually, yes, because I've been sitting on the videotape and the audio of this event for years now.
Now I know where you live, though.
Yeah. But for some reason,
do with me what you will, Doug.
I think I've seen a little bit of publication of that, you know, more handheld, you know, like iPhones.
Yeah, there were some.
Yeah.
Well, you know, the 50th anniversary.
Sounds like a good vacation to me.
Yeah.
No shit. So, Dimitri Bronson wouldn't be involved in that?
Oh, I can't say at this point. Yeah. I don't think the people that are organizing it really know. No, I don't have anything to do with that. If they ask me, I'll offer some. But what's interesting to me about it is that, you know, right now they're talking about bringing two original Sergers from the U.S., myself being one. Kevin Wayne. Yeah.
Cool.
And
I would love to see that, bro. Especially Kevin, because his system wasn't up for the 40th. He had some technical problems.
You saw where
that's
he lived,
believable.
You understand it.
No, it's totally believable.
Yeah, there's a theme here with pigeon droppings, rats eating, stuff like that.
Water collapsing from the ceiling and so forth.
Yes. Serge is a calamity oriented.
Well, it's vulnerable. The powers of rust.
It's sturdy.
So anyway, that's going to be interesting because there are two installations that have big surges over there in Paris, apparently. And so one of them is interested. They're trying to get the other one interested. And there's going to be like, they need some repairs. So we bring Kevin over.
I see, Fly him with some nice cheese and wine.
I like them crafty French people. They just kind of multi-purposing your visit there.
Well, actually, it's a selling point. It's like, because they were like all into, okay, yeah, well, we'll have Kevin over here to fix this thing. It's like, why don't we do something a little bit more?
Yeah, good for you.
Well, it was this fellow in France that I met. But
yeah, you'd made mention of that before.
Yeah,
I'd like to see
so
that.
Appropriate. I mean, Serge is there.
I'd like to see like the mystery Serge travel a little bit. I think it would probably stand up to a plane ride, but
not a chance in this world. Nope.
Yes, sir.
Don't you just book it a seat, like
yes,
a cello
sir.
Or something, and carry it with you?
No, I've asked. Kevin and I spoke at length about it, and he said that it's a suicidal idea, and that's why I had the Australian LB system.
I see.
Was because that was for travel, and I have boxes.
No,
for
that's very sensible. It's just that it looks sturdy from the outside, but
well, it is sturdy, but you know, going down ramps and all this kind of thing, it's dangerous, and you can't be sure that they'll let you carry it all the way through. You get to one point, they go, sorry, you're going to have to check it then.
No, you got that going on for you.
So whereas the other stuff, the healthy stuff that I got was made to be checked. I didn't carry any of that on the check it all the time.
Oh, okay. Cool. Good move on your part.
I didn't want to sacrifice my Serge for one performance.
No. Plus, you don't mind getting more gear in your life.
Well, there's that, plus it's a lot less weight, though. I mean,
yeah,
that was
no,
thing.
I agree. I agree with all of that.
That one box of Serge is 55 pounds.
Oh, yes. Didn't realize that. Now, when you say it like that, it does seem pretty substantial. The power supply is inside the box.
It is.
Yeah, okay.
And then it's a wooden case with metal sides on
it. Well, I guess it's wood. I mean, it's a road case, but I guess it's wood.
Yeah.
Or some sort of wood.
With a vinyl covering or a
something.
Yeah.
But it's time for that to get back in the shop again. As a matter of fact, I spoke to Kevin just the other day about having your Serge stabilized and everything. So
what sort of stabilization are you suggesting, sir?
Well, make sure that all of the pots and LEDs and everything are securely attached to the faceplate.
Some soldering and
some of the pots are scratchy beyond.
Yeah.
They have to be replaced.
No, it's an old system and
the NTO has stopped working.
Hmm.
Huh. I turned it on a couple of weeks ago and it just didn't work. So that's another thing. I don't think it's anything more than a brittle wire.
It may be something else. And if I'm not mistaken, Dimitri Bronson was saying that that's a common occurrence for that particular module. And that it's not a really super hard fix.
No, I really don't think it's probably much more than a brittle wire. That system's old enough to have brittle wire
problems. Oh, most definitely.
And, I'm going to give him the thing that I did when I went through it, that I shared with you. And then he'll go through it and we'll figure something out. But he's been very nice. He's agreed, since we're good friends, that, I pay him over time or whatever, but he'll get this done for me before I can really afford to do it. So that's what I need, is some people, supporting the project like that.
Well, my personal knowledge is there's one or two modules that just don't work.
Right, that's the variable slope module.
Yeah,
there were a few odds and ends, but nothing that's a big deal.
It's really sweet to see
even
that
one. Yeah, well,
it's possible.
I was talking to Kevin about this the other day. The chips that are used there had very variable buffer settings, so they could be set in such a way that it wasn't seeing enough for anything to happen out of the channel. I mean, sometimes it's
like
not
capacitor aged and
something. So he says there's some possibility that we might be able to fix it without actually doing anything other than calibrating it again.
It'd be exciting to see that, that stream effect to spec again.
Yeah, because I, you know, when people come in to work with it, I don't want to have them have to work around things, because that's not a good experience.
And
I mean, if one module goes out, it's fine, but I mean, it just as a concept, that's not really a...
Especially if you're just introducing a string or to a string system.
Right.
You kind of want to at least give them a manual or a little diagram for them to be, that's reliable.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I'm excited to do that, but I'm also excited to make some music with it before it goes away, like I already have.
Good.
But,
and good music it was, too. I really was, as usual, very shocked and appalled by your creative ability, goddammit.
Which, you know, it was interesting after both Richard and I watched that to both comment about, you know, your style is different. It's the same instrument. But all three of us, in approaching it, it sounds different.
Yeah.
And a lot of it is because of the open nature of the instrument itself. And that's another thing that makes this project really interesting, is the idea of having something that's as amorphous as this instrument and be able to just present it to different human beings and see what happens, you know?
Well, to me, yeah, that's the big, that's one of the big payoffs.
It's not like a mini mode. You know, it's not like, different players have different styles with pre-made non-modular synthesizers, but, you know, I just feel like this is something different, where it's such an open palette that it leads to different results.
Yeah, actually, you know, in order to put it differently, maybe, too, is that in order to actually copy somebody else's style on Serge, you have to be playing Serge for a really long time. You know how to get out of your own thing.
I was watching you, and I was kind of like, wow, okay, what's he doing there, you know? And I was kind of like tracing the patch chords, you know, and, oh, okay, that's what he's got going on. Oh, okay, that's why it's more filtered, you know?
Well, I do it in that patch. I have, within the wad, there's a feedback circuit. The original circuit comes into the auxiliary. The auxiliary flange goes out at this channel one.
Yeah.
And that's how I was using it.
Yes.
And to me, you know, you were mentioning the feedback use of it, which was a big part of what I was doing. And to me, it sounds so unique. Those, when you get a tone out of feedback, it sounds like it was made by physical instruments.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah.
Yes.
Harmonic series. Yeah. Yeah.
And so, yeah, I was really enjoying those, the timbre of those feedback tones from the wad. It's just like a really real...
There's nothing out there that sounds like it. There just isn't. I mean, you know, you can try with other stuff. I've tried with other stuff. But, you know, just the nature, again, elegant, simple electronics. There's this purity of tone. It's wild and crazy and not, you know, it's not like you get at the corner store, you know. Much more personal machine.
Yeah. Yeah, very much so. It's a DNA thing for me at this point. I mean, I feel like I'm just an extension of it.
Yeah.
This is a patch cord here.
It's a lot of work to get to that point, bro. But that's the way it should
be. It's the place to be.
Yeah, that's the way it should be. I mean, I'm sure that the Levins, you know, spent like hours with his head like on the keyboard, you know. So just to digress to something else, you know. It fits.
Yeah, yeah.
No, he quite literally played. But it takes a lot to sort of just get in line with the capabilities of the instrument, and it takes time and repetition and passion.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's one of the things that I see a lot in the contemporary modular world is people moving along before they've had a chance to, you know, see what their passion can do to the choice they made. You know,
interesting.
I kind of feel very proud, and sometimes very antique, but mostly very proud that, you know, I'm still playing the instrument that I got almost 50 years ago, and I still get things out of it that are new and exciting. And so it's like, you know, why get other stuff? There are are reasons. I don't need to be all fuddy-duddy about it, but just like getting other Serge stuff, like the Wad all of a sudden. Oh, other things come out.
No, I advocate getting new instruments just to inspire you, because every instrument has a sort of a different quality. And I started playing guitar maybe like around 5-6 years ago, but I'm not a guitar player. We just like practice scales. And just the act of physically moving up and down the fretboard and listening to the relationship of the different, you know, like strings and so forth, it will inspire your subconscious with melodic information that you can then transfer into composition.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, playing different instruments always brings new things out of it.
Yeah.
I am a lifelong guitar player, but a couple of years ago, to be able to play along with my wife, I picked up ukulele, which I've never played before. It's not hard for me to play conceptually because it's just a portion of a guitar. But the funny thing is when you're focusing only on the four strings and then you go back to guitar, all of a sudden there's all this stuff you can play that you never think about before, you know?
Well, the four string concept is a very blues man concept. I think it springs from the banjo and so forth. Mm. But quite a lot of the blues guys, you know, just eliminated the lower string for whatever reason, you know. And of course, that's five strings, but it changes the way you bar chords and so forth.
Right, and you know, and the funny thing is too, what I was discovering is that on a ukulele, you know, the fourth string in, which I play is an octave lower than a traditional ukulele, but still. You know, when you're playing six strings, that voice never speaks out, typically, because it's, you know, lost in the middle of the structure.
Yeah.
But, you know, when there's no strings below it, then all of a sudden those middle voices are singing out and you can do all sorts of things,
yeah.
You know. And then I started doing that on guitar, purposefully isolating strings to try to get to that there. It's very interesting how instruments influence how you use
them. I'm glad you agree. You know, I think that's profoundly true, you know.
Yeah, and just where the resonance is on a particular instrument might make you choose to play a lot in one key versus another.
Yeah, and every instrument is constructed slightly different too, guys, so, you know, there you go.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a... Instruments are really extensions of humanness, I think.
We hope so.
Well, even the crappiest one in the world in hands that are not afraid of it and feel comfortable with it, amazing things.
Some of the most musical stuff I've done has been with some of the crummiest stuff I've got.
You know,
it's more about just getting back to what Richard said, being inspired. And again, it part of the value in an instrument like this is that it's so chameleon-like that, yeah, sure, I can get bored here and there, but ultimately, the instrument's an open book. It's not been predetermined for me by some marketers and producers, and as a result, you know, God, this is so trite, you know, your imagination is your only limit. The big challenge, of course, is to, like, how do I keep my imagination free? And it gets right back to what Richard was saying about, okay, go out and acquire something else.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I still keep a bass guitar around for that same reason. I don't really play bass.
Mm-hmm.
I can pretend, but for the most part, I've got the bass guitar around because it, when I pick it up, it connects me with a different way of looking at tonality, and then I might just pick it up for 15 minutes or so and then put it down, but then when I go back to the piano keyboard, I might actually play with more open voices than I would otherwise.
Right, yeah. That's something that a guitar encourages, open voices, where a piano, you know, you're kind of...
Get those notes out there.
Get them in, all squished in here together, you know?
Well, every chord that you have available on the piano is essentially underneath your fingers. If you, you know, like a really hip about your inversions and so forth, you don't have to reach around. Like, I mean, it's just all right there, and, you know, like editing the various pitches. But that's why I brought up the
into the sound, into the small bits of it. I remember when I saw what to me was the birth of ambient music, which was when I saw my then teacher Howard Budd play his first song from his series, I think it was called The Golden Note, or The Court of the Golden Note, or something like that. But anyway, it was a, you know, we were in a room at CalArts, and it had a big buzzboard for a piano in it, and he hit this big chord with the sustain pedal on, and let it sustain until it died. That was the piece. And it was just a gorgeous experience, you know, to realize that I'm not the only person on the world, in the world, that listens to the inside of the sound more than the outside.
You know, that's part of the value. You know, I made mention a couple of times about this idea of simple sounds or simple productions, and yet, you know, when you step back from that, there's grit in the waveform. There's a bit of noise. That simple sweep of frequency sometimes reveals certain shifts in timbre that are more akin to what you get out of, say, a violin or something. And I think there's value in things like just making an oscillator out of a 555 chip and just running that into something else, because the nature of it is not pure. It's not particularly scientific. It's like a little critter, and you know, sometimes that critter can be a lot more fun to interact with than something that's very cold and scientific and does exactly what you want.
Mm-hmm. Right. It does exactly what you want, but it doesn't do a lot of things.
I have a Nord Modular. I love my Nord Modular. But that Nord Modular has got a real specific role now. I also have a lot of control voltage analog stuff. But the analog stuff can go so far, but then I run out of money, basically, you know, because there's just no more oscillators. I lose precision. I can then take a complex patch I built with the analog stuff and then replicate it on the Nord Modular. And now I've got something which might not have the same sonic signature, but that concept that got me patching things together, I can carry it a little bit further into this direction where it's got its own really cool sound quality, but ultimately, it's too clean, too precise. It doesn't have that living characteristic that keeps me exploring. You know, I kind of need that fuzziness.
Yeah. People have said to me that the Serge sounds more organic.
Absolutely.
Synthesizers.
Yeah. And depending on the era of the oscillator I go to, even more so. But it most definitely. Because there's, you know, there's always been that element of chaos in the Serge builds that I kind of adjusted to. I mean, Serge was a little more precise when he was vending his instruments and say which variant was, but the soldering wasn't consistent, and there were mistakes made, and. If the customer doesn't know, then it's not a problem.
It's not a mistake. It's a feature.
That was that Buchla is notorious for that as well. You know, no, it's not broken. You just have to rethink how you're using it.
You're just imagining it doing the wrong things.
Which I totally embrace, frankly. I mean, I like aleatory concepts and aleatory music. Random is fine with me, you know. And I personally adore academic synthesis from, you know, like say the 60s and the 70s, where the University of Ohio releases their LP from the graduate class of electronic music. And, I was an avid follower of all that minutia. Yeah.
Yeah, there was a lot of amazing stuff going on back in those days. It's interesting now that modular has made such a comeback, but I don't think it's really come back in the universities. Maybe
no.
I'm wrong.
No, I think you're right.
Because they're still on the digital
work process thing.
That's really where the work palette is for these guys. You know, my understanding is that, and you may have told me this story, but my understanding is that a donation to CalArts, recent donation to CalArts, is not being maintained.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
That was, I was telling you about
blackface.
Daryl's Johansson's blackface. That's
which is
that's
really
sad.
A shame.
That's a beautiful instrument.
Yeah. So anyway, but it's like trying to teach film photography at this point. It's just, it's, shouldn't do it, guys. I know you professors grew up with that stuff, but it's not relevant to the work palette of the 21st century.
So let me be sure I understand. So which, what is not relevant? The analog is not relevant to the 21st century? Is that what you're, or the?
Yeah, I'm saying that, like, in terms of photography or even, you know, people are more in the box. It's more, you know, and that's where it should be. And if you're gonna vend product and you're gonna try and make a career out of something, you gotta be current with your tool so that you can interface with it. That's really what I was trying to say.
Gotcha.
And that there's a massive lag between the analog, between the academic, you know, like, age of the professorial generation as to the children that are coming through and getting their tools. And they need more contemporary tools. And those tools are changing, like, minute by minute.
Oh, yeah. If you didn't learn something new today, then you'd be way behind.
Yeah.
Huh. Well,
I agree.
As I see the sun setting on the ocean here.
It's getting a bit chilly for a young man.
I still got
like
a red indicator
too.
Light that says that battery's not died yet.
Let me just make sure that it's been recording. That would suck. Oops, that would suck too. And I just lost your...
Oh, I just carried mine along.
Whee!
So I've got an hour and 47 on here. Which I think is just about how much I've got 50 minutes left, it says. No, yeah.
Okay, what have I got going on here?
Can I retreat to your car?
Retreat?
To your car while you break down?
Absolutely.
Would you help me out of this? Or?
Yeah.
Let me get out of mine first.